Morning, everyone, and welcome to our fourth Global Leaders Conversation here at the Aspen Security Forum. I'm Anya Manuel. We are very, very happy to have with us today an old friend of Aspen, an old friend of the Aspen Strategy Group, President of Afghanistan, Ashraf Ghani, who's taken time out of his very busy schedule to be with us at this beginning of the new Biden administration. I'll introduce him quickly, and then we'll move to questions. President Ghani grew up in Afghanistan before leaving for the West, becoming a leading scholar of political science, working at the World Bank. After the fall of the Taliban in late 2001, he went back to his home country and served ably as finance minister under President Karzai. He also later ran the Transition Coordination Commission, the TCC, which was responsible for transferring authority from foreign to national troops. After his government service, he moved back to the United States briefly and spent some time at the Aspen Institute, leading a market building initiative with Claire Lockhart. And then, of course, famously, in late 2013, he ran for president and was declared winner in 2014. It's a difficult time in Afghanistan. President Ghani is running his country ably, but as many of you know, the peace talks between the government and Taliban are slowly resuming. They barely resumed in January, but the Taliban has stepped up attacks on civilians, on journalists, women, et cetera. So it's time for the new Biden administration to energize this peace process, and this conversation couldn't come at a better time. To interview President Ghani, we have Carol Lee. We're pleased to partner again with NBC, as we often do, to produce this conversation. Carol is a leading reporter for NBC Network on Afghanistan, North Korea, the Middle East, and elsewhere. Prior to joining NBC, she worked at the Wall Street Journal and Politico, and was also president of the White House Correspondents Association. And she also interviewed for us this summer at the Aspen Security Forum, interviewed Ambassador Bolton. So thank you, Carol. Thank you, President Ghani. I'll let you take it from here.
Thank you so much, Anya. And Mr. President, thank you for being here. I know everyone is very eager to hear what you have to say. So let's just get right to it. You spoke with Secretary Blinken yesterday. Your National Security Advisor spoke with President Biden's National Security Advisor earlier this week. What are your initial takeaways in terms of what the Biden administration might do differently in terms of its approach to Afghanistan? And do you expect to speak with President Biden anytime soon?
Well, thank you. And thank you, Ms. Manuel, for that introduction. First of all, let me wish President Biden great success in his first 100 days. I hope that they're as substantial and as impactful as FDR's. Secretary Blinken demonstrated last night that what he told the Senate in his confirmation hearings, that no matter how hard the problem, the US will be there, has been heartening. The first consequence is an agreement on a process. The United States is going to send the team to Kabul, and we will also be talking by video conferencing on how to energize the peace process, how to make sure that it meets its stated goal of an end state of a sovereign, democratic, united Afghanistan. He promised me robust diplomacy in the region, full coordination with us, and a focus on ending 40 years of violence. The goal is to secure a legacy that would both ensure United States' interest and the great sacrifice. 2,448 American men and women died. We pay tribute to the Gold Star families. Tens of thousands of Afghans, if sacrificed, we are holding our freedom, and the presence of the United States now troops is now 2,500. I do expect a call from President Biden, Secretary Blinken, and National Security Advisor both graciously said that he will call me. Of course, given COVID, we will be as patient and as for as much time as is required, but the process has begun. We couldn't be more pleased with the early, focused, systematic attention and a dialogue between two partners that have mutually sacrificed and have mutual interest and will base their relationship on mutual trust and mutual respect.
Mr. President, as you know, the Biden administration is reviewing the U.S. deal with the Taliban. And yesterday, the Pentagon spokesman said the Taliban have not met their commitments in that deal. What is your expectation of the results of that view and the timing?
The timing is not going to be very long. This will not be similar to the exercise that President Obama undertook in his first months, because then the question was the scale of intervention. We should not expect that type of review. It is likely to be several weeks, not months. The issue is there are conditions, and the approach was everything must be met in order for the agreement to work. In here, the UN National Security Monitoring Group has been on record that the Taliban have not met their obligations for severing their ties with terrorist networks in general and with Al-Qaeda in particular. Second, we released 5,500 prisoners, which was unprecedented move. And we were assured by the Secretary of State and the Special Envoy that there will be ceasefire or a very substantial reduction of violence. Instead, violence has peaked and it's an attack on all our institutions, as Professor Manuel mentioned. Third, there was the expectation that genuine peace talks will take place. Since 5th of January, we've returned to the first, just agreeing on the procedures took over 4 months. Second, since 5th of January, our delegation has been in Doha. The Taliban are finding one excuse after another not to meet. And there's an expectation again, of course, that a political settlement will involve direct talks meaningful talks between the government of Afghanistan representing the people of Afghanistan and the Taliban. The agenda has not been agreed yet, so we need to move. What has happened off the table is that peace has not been socialized to the Taliban commanders or rank and files. Their leaders have taken pictures with suicide bombers and met wounded people in hospitals in Karachi and others. There's, in addition to these, the question that is very much on the agenda is two. One, sanctuary. The Taliban must agree to end their sanctuary to be part of the Afghan society. Second, their relations with drugs. Drug production by them and distribution is increased 30% at least. And now they're producing amphetamine. So if we want stability, the threat from drugs to every family in the region and the world must also be addressed. We have a substantial agenda. This is, and we are ready for meaningful talks that would end the violence. They must reciprocate. I think a condition-based approach to this, not an endless time, but a meaningful amount of time would be extremely important. The Taliban's narrative was that they defeated the United States, that the United States and NATO were on the run. Now, robust diplomacy and a stand on condition-based approaches will enable us all, hopefully, to resume meaningful discussions. And this would be a predictable process where all the U.S. government, the military side, the intelligence side, and the diplomatic side would be engaged, and the decisions would be predictable, which would allow us to adjust.
You said this week that a new chapter has opened in relations between Afghanistan and the U.S. one of the things that's not new or different with the Biden administration is the U.S. envoy, Saul Khalilzad, who Biden decided to keep in that role. Your government has been critical of his approach to Afghanistan. Given that, what message does it send to you that President Biden has decided to keep him on as the envoy? And do you think that role will remain the same in the coming months, or that it will change as the Biden administration progresses?
First of all, the team is changing. Ambassador Khalilzad is continuing, but new people representing the views of President Biden and Secretary Blinken are appointed to the team. Second, an envoy carries the instruction of his president and the Secretary of State. I think that now we have a new set of instructions coming within a new frame. We work with whomever the Biden administration decides to appoint or to continue. The question is not to me, because the expectations are not mine. It's the expectation of the Biden administration from its envoy.
It sounds like you think there'll be others who are leading this role in the coming months, and yet it's not necessarily just going to be.
Ambassador Khalilzad is an old friend. He was a classmate. You know, we go back a long way. So I don't want to make any comments. We have two very different functions. I represent the people of Afghanistan. He's an employee of the U.S. government. We will work with whomever, but our interests are what are important in the manner. Now, Ambassador Khalilzad would be reporting to a very organized decision-making process. And we are assured that that will work. And we are looking very much forward to working with the new administration.
Okay, fair enough. I want to ask you about troop numbers. Do you believe the Biden administration should stick with the U.S. troop withdrawal plan in May or switch course? And do you think 2,500 is enough? What is your ideal number?
The numbers are not my job. The question is, what is U.S. interest? What is the threat of terrorism? What is required to ensure the legacy? Those questions, I'm very confident, are being considered by extremely wise and experienced people. General Miller is a first-rate general. We've been very lucky with U.S. Commanders for ISAF and for the Resolute Support Mission. The views of those generals, including General Dunford, who just retired as Chief of Staff, but was commanding in Afghanistan, once they are taken into account, I think the right decision on the numbers would be made. Regarding timing, it's the review that will make a decision on this. And if the initial announcements from Pentagon that have said that the level of violence is unacceptable and Taliban are responsible for this, then it is likely to be a decision to send that signal to the Taliban that the U.S. is here to secure peace and not to retreat and leave the field open to them.
How concerned are you if the U.S. leaves and NATO follows suit that ISIS will be able to gain a foothold in Afghanistan?
Issues. One, the Afghans are responsible for Afghanistan. We will fight to death to deny our country to the terrorists. Nobody should underestimate our resolve. None of us has plans to live somewhere else or to abandon this country that we love so much and has suffered so much. Second, terrorism has become an ecosystem, not just a series of isolated groups. The fight, Ms. Lee, is not in Afghanistan, it is over Afghanistan. Our location is both the blessing and the curse. The blessing, because we are the shortest route between Central Asia and South Asia, in East Asia and West Asia. So we have these wonderful visions that are now being realized, railways, transmission lines, pipelines, you name it. And our natural wealth is finally being explored. Investments are taking place. The other is that in the narrative of ISAS and others, we are the site of the end of the world battle. In their eschatology, Afghanistan is this place that their final fight must take place. This is, again, we do not want to exaggerate or underestimate. We want a joint understanding on the threat of terrorism. Because if Afghanistan, God forbid, is left without a political settlement that brings peace, every terrorist group is going to migrate here and target us. Already, over 25 are here. And they are linked, they are trained by the Taliban, they are supported by them, they are nurtured by them. It's a competitive but also very cooperative relationship. Will the commitments of the Taliban have meaning? What is the verification mechanism? If we want to be assured that there is genuine peace, we must have verifiable mechanisms. And also, during the period, any transitional period, we agree, in terms of incorporating their fighters into our security forces, how this is done is going to be extremely important, because we don't want peace between two armed camps. And the type of arrangements that produced Hezbollah in Lebanon or other type of arrangements where the mechanisms of ceasefire were not thought through or dangerous. We need to be very clear that the Afghan National Defense and Security Forces have won this country with their blood. They have made an incredible journey from being just dependent to the very large international force to having taken priority. So a lot of issues in front of us. But what is important, I think, is that it's going to be a very predictable relationship.
With the Biden administration, you mean?
With the Biden administration.
I want to ask you about the intra-Afghan peace talks. You've said that you will transfer power to an elected successor, but the Taliban and some in the U.S. see your decision to stay in power as an impediment to an ultimately getting a peace deal. Can you explain why not hand over power to an interim government and let them take over the process, if that would smooth the way to peace?
Absolutely. Great question. What would be the legitimacy? From where would this interim government derive its legitimacy? Will the Afghan security and defense forces accept its orders? I mean, when we say interim, and three, how will they deal with the constitution? A Republican system is an inbuilt system of transfer. The minute you agree on, you have elections. We must agree on the date of the election so that we have the full legal transfer of authority. We've had interim governments. They've led to bloodshed. People of Kabul was destroyed in 1992 by an interim government. A prime minister was bombarding his president, and the president had to fight back with the prime minister. The prime minister, Mr. Hikmatyar, never came to Kabul. We've had agreements in Mecca, in Herat, in Charasia, and Jalalabad. None of them helped. It is important. And then when Dr. Najib, the last Soviet-backed government, agreed to a transitional mechanism, what happened? Total collapse. We need to learn from the past. It's not I am the obstacle, because I've championed peace. Has there been any decision, no matter how hard, that I have not made, like securing the release of 400 Taliban hardened criminals that are now 90% of them on the front lines of the battle? Where were the assurances that Dr. Khalilzad gave us on these? If the Taliban been truthful to the United States with saying that they are going to bring a substantial reduction of violence or ensure that these people are not going to fight, we need to have political consensus. Bottom up, the citizens of Afghanistan must be empowered. Will the women of Afghanistan and the youth who are really leading the country be trustful that tomorrow their lives are secure? There are significant questions. This is based on an old-fashioned theory. It's called an elite deal. Francis Fukuyama has written a beautiful paper saying that this elite deal didn't even apply to 17th century England. An orderly process is critical to stability. I'm not hanging to power, I'm working 16 hours a day. What benefit do I get? I don't have a political family, I don't have a political party. Mm-hmm. So it's crucial. And last point, from where would I have the authority to dissolve the Republic? I've sworn I carry the Constitution of Afghanistan with me continuously. It says I'm sworn to uphold this Constitution. And this says that chapter 1 and 2 cannot be amended on the basic rights and on the character of the state. So our colleagues need to come with more imaginative views than saying I'm the obstacle. That was old fashioned. I think it's not needed in this context.
Okay. You mentioned women and girls. I want to talk to you about that. There's a lot of concern about a peace deal coming at the expense of the rights of women. How can you be sure that the outcome in these talks will indeed be beneficial to women and girls?
Well, thank you. First, you know, our ambassadors to the United States and the United Nations both are women. You've seen Ambassador Rahmani's op-ed. The women of Afghanistan cannot be pushed back. The Taliban's problem was that they grew in a totally male environment in Pakistani madrasas. This does not represent our past. It does not represent our culture. Two, that's precisely why talk of mechanisms like interim governments is irresponsible. How do we ensure that rights are carried, that people have a place? You have to have ironclad agreements and verification and monitoring mechanisms that everybody adheres. Many peace agreements have been in the nature of Trojan horses. They've promised the moon, but when it's come, they've done the opposite. We want to make sure that the women of Afghanistan, based on our religion, which this is a 99.99% Muslim country, can have their rights. We had a prophet, our prophet, peace be upon him. His wife was the richest woman in Saudi Arabia, he worked for her. Most of his sayings have been transmitted by the second wife that came after the death of. In our history, women have played a very significant role. We need to make sure that we are not bound by some recent interpretation that does not have rooting in our civilization and culture. The Taliban refused to argue with us on Islamic grounds. Please show me one major scholar in the world that now supports their interpretation. This is a narrow interpretation that is derived from a limited group of madrasas in Pakistan. People of Afghanistan need to be empowered. And of course, our habits, our customs, our cultural interactions between men and women are important, but they are respectful. And women have made their place. They're ministers now, they're ambassadors, they're judges, they're members of parliament, every walk of life. That if anybody dreams that they're going to go back to sewing and having circles of reading, that's an illusion.
But Mr. President, if the Taliban control more territory, how can you guarantee that women will maintain their rights? What specific steps can you take to ensure that?
Well, sure. One, We are going towards a digitalization strategy. We are going to transform this year, 2021 would be a year where Afghanistan really embraces digitalization, where distance learning, telemedicine are going to be the core of it. But what is really significant, the women from wherever, even Taliban, are dominant services are provided by the Afghan government. And we want to make sure that we reach them. Territory, most of the territory that they hold are either mountains or deserts. If one focuses on population and not just extent of land, you will see that this is a very narrow base. So it's again extremely important that this does not get exaggerated and that type of ceasefire is not implemented that gives them a lot more than they have. But the most fundamental part are conditions. We must reach an agreement where education of girls, medical services to them, child mortality and women mortality at birth has been halved. It's been cut by 50%. But the next 25% is hard and the 25% after that. Polio, they have prevented a polio vaccination campaign, polio research. This year we expected to eliminate polio. Unfortunately, their lack of understanding and lack of cooperation brought a surge. They love their children like any other human being. They must allow us to reach out and deal with it, and deal with it together.
I want to ask you about coronavirus. Can you just update us on the coronavirus situation in your country? How is Afghanistan's health system coping with the coronavirus pandemic? And are there pledges, are these pledges to get the Afghan people vaccinated from the World Health Organization and others? Is that enough? Do you need more?
Well, the first thing is the good news. We overcame two waves of the pandemic. The first one, from January to July, we were among the few countries that had accurately predicted the wave. Five phases: acknowledgement, diffusion, adversity, relief, recovery. There was no shortage of food. There was no breakdown of the market systems. We held a very strong lockdown of the cities, but we recovered. Most of it is because, I think, of our youth, 70.6%. So our casualties have been very low, but the economic impact were extremely severe. We went from an expected 4% growth in GDP to minus 5%. And for the first time, our cities were really hard hit. So we distributed bread, and now, if a program that covers 90% of the country that lives under $2 a day with assistance, with food-based assistance. The second wave came in September, was contained in January. The third wave, we don't know because we are surrounded by another. And again, the Vice President and I held over 20 meetings on the first wave and wrote the articulated, and over 24 meetings with the health sector. Reform of the health sector is our priority. Our health sector was stretched but did not break. The bed occupancy is below 50% now. Vaccines are critical. We are promised by Gavi, the Global Alliance, vaccine for 20% of the population, the most vulnerable and the most big, the key workers. But it's not enough. We are mobilizing support to at least get to 60%. We hope that the cost will come. Fortunately, because of our dealing with polio, we have a cold storage system that would enable us to move. But this is a gigantic undertaking. We're lucky that we were able to manage corona during intense fighting. And unfortunately, the Taliban did not heed the call of Secretary General of the United Nations for a ceasefire. It again is an indicator. We wanted to provide assistance all across the country. They again refused. this very basic of the basic things.
Mr. President, thank you. I've just been told that we are wrapping up with this portion of the program and moving to a question and answer session with our audience. So I really appreciate your time. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Ms. Lee. Thank you for this opportunity. And again, best wishes to the people of the United States for quick recovery and distribution of vaccination.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Carol. And thank you, President Ghani. We've learned a lot already just in the last 30 minutes. I'd now like to give our audience an opportunity to ask questions. But let me take the moderator's prerogative. And while General Petraeus is coming up, who of course led our NATO and US forces in Afghanistan about 10 years ago, I'd like to ask you one optimistic one in between. You said previously that 70% of the population of Afghanistan is under 30. What is the most hopeful thing you see in Afghanistan today?
We will be one of the key countries in the region. Our location is going to turn into solid gold. Every pipeline, every transmission line, et cetera. Two, an Australian company, Fortisco, has signed a memorandum of understanding with us to produce 20,000 megawatts of power from our hydro resources and convert this into green industry. If that happens, Afghanistan will take a jump like Singapore. We've signed the deal with Siemens for production of renewable energy. We have a potential of 75,000 megawatts from wind, North Sea velocity, 120 days, 220,000 megawatts solar, and probably 10,000 from underground geothermal. Afghanistan is extraordinarily rich. The largest unexplored iron mine, copper mine, and particularly to the future of electrical car. We are called the Saudi Arabia of lithium. Both mountain lithium and ancient lakes are available. Prosperity really is around the corner. And Central Asia, what pleases us most, 10 years ago, 6 years ago, Afghanistan really didn't figure in the calculations of Central Asia. Now, all of them are considering Afghanistan the sixth member of Central Asia. After 120 years, we've rejoined. And our vision with the youth, this youth is moderate. It is future looking, it's extraordinarily connected. Now with that program that we have of digitalization, we have 1 million diaspora only in OECD countries, United States, Canada, Australia, Europe. If the power and the energy of diaspora, the third and second generation, is linked with this youth population and our capacity to network. We've been networkers across history. I think we can make it.
Thank you.
I'm very optimistic.
Thank you very much. It's good to hear that optimism. General Petraeus.
Thanks, Anya. And thanks, Mr. President, for what you continue to do for your country. It is great to see you. I, too, have been heartened that the Biden administration has engaged swiftly with your government and launched a review of the situation there and the level of resources now committed. And I say that in particular because I have a nagging fear as an old soldier that the drawdown of U.S. forces to below half the number that General Miller reportedly previously assessed was the minimum needed could prove inadequate in assisting and enabling the Afghan National Security Forces when the fighting season resumes after winter and could result in a worst case in a crumbling of the ANSF and then a collapse in certain parts of the country that ultimately could result in the need to evacuate diplomats, non-government organization personnel, international organizations, et cetera, and then lead eventually to the kind of civil war that we saw in the 1990s after the collapse of the Afghan government supported by the Soviets after their own departure. This is, of course, a worst case, again, but soldiers do get paid to consider worst cases, and its possibility does worry me. Are my fears misplaced?
Jim Petraeus, first of all, a tribute to both your generalship and diplomacy and enormous wisdom. You're the one of the world's leading economists now, not just your other characteristics. You've always had an iron discipline. Your fears are never unfounded because you don't speculate, you analyze. And one has to consider the worst case scenario, hope for the best, but prepare for the worst. And your input into this process, I hold General Miller in enormous respect, all of us do, and it's extremely important that he's listened to, because we've been very lucky. We've had you. You left the Central Command to take control in Afghanistan and produced enormous change. I had the pleasure of an honor of planning to transition with you, but a number that is necessary for the mission must be present. During the period when President Trump decided till now, NATO is played a bridging role. But you know that NATO without US enablers cannot continue its mission. So it's a consensus. I've spoken to Prime Minister of Australia, Prime Minister of Canada, Prime Minister of Norway, Chancellor Merkel, the Secretary General. NATO is very much interested in continuing, but they need US enablers. And your judgment on those enablers is really crucial to avoiding those type of scenarios. Because if Taliban realize that they can prevail through violence, they will not let go. And some of their supporters, unfortunately, are equally in that illusionary world. So combination of presence plus diplomacy, bringing US tools of power in a concentrated manner, the way it was done when you were commander, will be extremely crucial to our success.
Thank you very much, General Petraeus and President Ghani. We now have Milan Verveer, who of course was the ambassador at large for women's issues. I know you know her well, and you've already spoken eloquently, Mr. President, about women and all the achievements they've made in Afghanistan. So I'll pass it over to Milan. Thank you.
Hello, President Ghani, and it's so good to see you again, and thank you for this exchange. We have been witnessing and Afghans have been experiencing a terrible wave of assassinations and targeted violence directed at civil society leaders and other government leaders. We saw just in the last week, two female members of the Supreme Court gunned down, the head of the Election Monitoring Commission, etc. The Taliban are no longer taking responsibility for these killings, but there are many who believe that this may be a part of a new strategy of theirs to chill, to silence, to quash dissent. And I wonder how you see this and whether there is anything in the very short term that can be done because as you know better than anybody, it is having an incredible chilling effect on so many of the best and brightest of Afghanistan.
Well, thank you, Ambassador. It's a great pleasure to see you. Let me thank you on behalf of Afghan women and send you the greetings of the First Lady, who is a great admirer and all my fellow Afghan women citizens, as well as men, because men are now engaged. One of the most heartening things is that in Doha, the women of Afghanistan are totally supported and backed by men in general and by the Islamic scholars of Afghanistan in particular. So women's rights are an area, becoming an area of consensus, and their role is being accepted. On Kabul, first, I want to thank Vice President Saleh for having taken an incredible amount of time and effort every day. At 6:30 for 2 hours, he meets and he's going through every incident in Kabul, if a woman's purse is stolen or telephone or others, it's attended to. On crime, we've had a major impact, so women feel secure. But the two judges, Qudsi and Zakia, were both incredible people. I spoke to both their families. There isn't a day that I don't speak to families. In the short term, the first thing, hold the Taliban responsible for the environment of violence. If they don't take responsibility for individual assassinations, their refusal to take peace seriously and engage with us is responsibility itself. They have not condemned these things. The people we released, the 400 hardened criminals and drug dealers, they need to share information. What happened to these people? They had committed that none of them will take place in the fight. They've resumed. They've been heading the fight, and they've been, again, dealing with. Third, a unified voice. The Taliban were mollified. They were treated as though they were dignitaries and they need to be accommodated. The United States and NATO must take a very strong stand on the condition-based approach. They signed an agreement. That agreement now needs to be implemented. And lastly, we need support from civil society, from women's group and others in the world. We've established a fund for journalists and for civil society. Contributions to those funds will be extremely important. Moral support for these people, the voice from everywhere that people care as you do, will be important to give them. What is really remarkable is still how much heart there is and how determined the women are. Lastly, we need to increase the areas of work, the areas of employment for women. Some fields like journalism, they claim now, are becoming very difficult for them. So we have to work with them through a range of instruments to make sure that we are not going to retreat, because the aim is to frighten so that we stop emphasizing these issues. We must have the courage of our conviction, we will. And I hope that with your support, we'll be able to send a strong signal that this is not the way to get attention. It is the way to get condemnation for actions that are truly inhuman and unproductive.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. With that, President Kalani, I want to thank you, and I want to thank Carol for Lee for being here today. Thank you, President, for taking time out of your incredibly busy schedule. You have a lot of friends of Afghanistan in Washington and across the United States. We wish you well. We were so heartened to hear that you're already engaging with the new Biden administration. And here is to peace and the end of COVID in 2021. Thank you so much for being with us. Ladies and gentlemen, we will be back with the Aspen Security Forum next week with the President of Colombia. So please join us for that. Thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you. And please thank all my colleagues at the Aspen Security Forum. Thank you.
Will do. Thank you.